Be careful with the armadillo. Governors, I want to pause here for a second because we've got a rare opportunity. We have more presidential candidates than we know what to do with today. So, and you get the treat of being able to respond to what Hillary Clinton has to say. Let me pause here. Chris Hayes, my colleague, has Hillary Clinton on the phone. Chris, take it away. Like I said, we have so many presidential candidates, we don't know what to do with them right now. Then we'll go.
I like this format. I'm enjoying listening to Gary Wilson, Jerry Johnson, and Bill Weld, and we will get a chance to hear more from them in a second. Right now, joining me on the phone is Secretary of State Hillary Clinton. Ms. Clinton, are you there?
I am, Chris.
Oh, wonderful,
Madam. Can you hear me?
I can hear you, Madam Secretary. Thank you very much. Thank you for calling in. I wanted to, I guess, start by asking, Donald Trump today said that the press should be thankful to him, to Mr. Trump, for raising $5.6 million for veterans charities. He said, what is Hillary Clinton doing? What is your reaction to what happened at Trump Tower today?
Well, I think the problem here is the difference between what Donald Trump says and what Donald Trump does. You know, he's bragged for months about raising $6 million for veterans and donating $1 million himself, but it took a reporter to shame him into actually making his contribution and getting money to veterans groups. I, of course, over the course of my life, I've not only donated personally, but I have worked to provide hundreds of, millions of dollars over time to help our veterans by what I voted for, what I've worked for. Actually, John McCain and I helped raise funds for the Intrepid Fallen Heroes Fund to build a rehab facility at Brooke Army Medical Center in San Antonio so that our returning wounded vets could get world-class treatment. And ever since I was First Lady and in the public eye, I've worked to help victims of Agent Orange, those suffering from the mysterious illnesses from the first Gulf War, get help when no one else would listen. I worked on the Armed Services Committee to raise death benefits for families of the fallen from $12,000 to $100,000. I worked with Senator Lindsey Graham to expand health care benefits to the National Guard and Reserve, and have worked in every way I could in my public capacity to honor the service and provide the benefits and support that our veterans deserve.
Let me follow up on this aspect of it. There has been a tremendous amount of criticism directed at the VA for a variety of issues, chiefly wait times at VA hospitals, but a whole set of logistical challenges that veterans have faced. You have talked about how you see yourself inheriting the Obama administration. In your mind, is the care and the performance of the VA under this president acceptable? Is it an acceptable performance from the VA?
Well, Chris, I've been clear for months that the problems at the VA are unacceptable. And I have been outspoken on that. I've obviously worked when I was in the Senate to help veterans and their families. I think we've got to tackle some of the problems that have come to light. I don't agree with Republicans who want to use the problems as an excuse to privatize the VA and hand it over to the private insurance system to deal with, you know, terrible challenges like PTSD and traumatic brain injury and the like. I think we've got to, in my plan that I've put forward, provide for the VA to purchase more care from the private sector, but to act more as a guide and guardian for veterans, coordinating their care and ensuring their health outcomes. And I've been very, very proud and humbled to work with a lot of our veterans advocates and activists to try to make sure that if I'm fortunate enough to be president, I will come in immediately with a plan as to how we're going to deal with the problems that we've unearthed in the VA and do it in a very focused manner.
You have your campaign has canceled some events you were going to do in New Jersey, which, of course, votes on June 7th, along with California, headed instead to California. There are people who are interpreting that as a campaign that is nervous about winning California on what is a sort of big final day, except for D.C. Are you nervous about California?
Well, I'm feeling, very positive about my campaign in California. We are working really hard. I was proud to get Governor Jerry Brown's endorsement today. But I want to cover as much of the state as I possibly can. I will be in New Jersey tomorrow. I'm really looking forward to that. Actually, I'll be there for an event tonight. So we are competing everywhere. But I have been struck by some of the, you know, challenges California faces, like the drought, which Donald Trump said the other day didn't exist. And so I am spending time talking with citizens, with experts, with people who have lots of good ideas. I really want to be a good partner, not just to California, but the entire country. But I think California has some particular challenges, and I'm going to be campaigning up and down California, meeting with people and then putting forth, you know, my ideas about what I can do as president.
Donald Trump and Republicans have made a great deal of both the IG report on email use, but more than that, they've invoked the specter of the FBI quite often. And so I need to ask you if you have been contacted by the FBI about an interview regarding the email situation.
No, we do not have an interview scheduled. And I just want to say a word about the recent report. You know, actually, the report makes clear that personal email use was a practice under other secretaries of state. And the rules were not clarified until after I had left. But as I've said many times, Chris, it was still a mistake. If I could go back, I would do it differently. And I understand people who have concerns about it, but I hope voters look at the full picture of everything I've done in my career and actually the full threat posed by a Donald Trump presidency, because if they do, I have faith in the American people that they will make the right choice here.
One final small follow-up on that. There was just one line in that IG report that stuck out to me, and I just wanted to get clarification from you directly, in which the IG found that a subordinate of yours had told people to stop asking about your use of private email, and that was a striking phrase. Is that true to your knowledge?
I do not know who that person is or, you know, what that person, you know, might have said, because it is not anything that I am aware of. I emailed with hundreds of people, and I emailed department officials and others directly with my email, as other secretaries have done. I certainly never instructed anyone to hide the fact I was using a personal email. Right. It was obvious to hundreds of people, visible to the many people that I was emailing throughout the State Department and the rest of the federal government.
All right, Madam Secretary, thank you very much for making yourself available today. Appreciate it.
Thank you. Great to talk to you. Bye-bye.
Talk to you soon. All right, Chuck.
it's an unusual day.
It is an unusual day. Thank you very much. And we now back to your regular scheduled programming.
Well, and more importantly, back to another presidential candidate. Perhaps this is a preview for later in the fall. Chris Hayes, well done. We'll see you at 8. So let me bring back Gary Johnson and Bill Weld. Well, Gary Johnson, if you get on that presidential debate stage with Hillary Clinton, how would you have responded to her just now?